to time. And you lay down your life to save us. And you took all our shame on the cross, he was led. And now you're taking us higher. Cause we go from glory to glory to glory. We'll never be the same. We'll never be the same. We go from glory to glory to glory. We're forever changed, forever changed. And you call me a friend and brought into your endless kingdom. By the blood I was made, no longer a slave. And now you're taking us higher. We go from glory to glory to glory. We'll never be the same. We'll never be the same. Cause we go from glory to glory to glory. We're forever changed.
Forever change. We're forever changed. my mother's womb. You formed me with your hands, known and loved by you. Before I took a breath, when I doubted, Lord, remind me I'm wonderfully made. You're an artist and a potter. I'm the canvas and the clay. And you make all things work together for my future and for my good. You make all things work together for your glory and for your name. There's a healing light just beyond the clouds. Though I've walked through fire,
with me,
You're not finished with me, no. You're not, oh, you're not finished. You're not finished with me. You're not finished with me. You're not finished with me. Oh, when I doubt it, oh, and when I doubt it, Lord, remind me I'm wonderfully made. You're an artist and a potter. I'm the chemist and the clay, and I know nothing has been wasted. No failure or mistake. You're an artist and a potter. I'm the chemist and the clay.
Nothing we could do would be enough. lies. We have failures. We have faults. We have insecurities. But listen to me. Jesus looks into our lives, to the very soul of who we are, and He says, I can make you immovable. Because breakthroughs, revelations, victories, and miracles only come by you knowing what it is that you are desiring and fighting for it. You need to settle in your heart. You are not a mistake. You are not an accident. You're a miracle. The very fact that you're here this morning, that's a miracle. We have failures, we have faults, we have insecurities, but listen to me, Jesus looks into our lives, to the very soul of who we are, and He says, I can make you immovable. Because breakthroughs, revelations, victories, and miracles only come by you knowing what it is that you are desiring and fighting for it. You need to settle in your heart. You are not a mistake. You are not an accident. You're a miracle. The very fact that you're here this morning, that's a miracle.
Let's stand, sing a few songs and worship tonight. Hallelujah. Let's sing the song out. Jesus is the rock.
There is no rock. There is no God like our God.
No other name.
No other name worthy of all our praise. Well, he's the rock of salvation that cannot be moved. He's proven himself to be faithful and true. There is no rock, there is no God like ours.
From the top.
There is no rock, there is no God like our God.
No other name.
No other name worthy of all our praise. Well, he's the rock of salvation that cannot be moved. He's proven himself to be faithful and true. There is no rock, there is no God like ours.
Let's sing it out, church. Rock of ages.
Rock of ages. Yes, Jesus is the rock, rock of ages. Yes, Jesus is the rock, rock of ages. Yes, Jesus is the rock, and there is no rock. There is no God like ours. And there is no rock. There is no God like our God.
No other name.
No other name worthy of all our praise. Well, he's the rock of salvation that cannot be moved. Proven himself to be faithful and true. There is no rock, and there is no God like ours.
Rock of ages.
Rock of ages. Yes, Jesus is the rock. Rock of ages. Yes, Jesus is the rock, rock of ages. Yes, Jesus is the rock. And there is no rock, there is no God like ours.
Let's give God praise tonight, church. Thank you. God, let's continue to clap our hands tonight, church. The Bible tells us in Psalms 150, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Let's do that tonight.
Every praise
is to our God. Every word of worship with one accord. Every praise is to our God.
Every
hallelujah to our God. Glory, hallelujah, is to our God. Every praise is to our God.
Let's sing it out. God, my Savior.
And God, my Savior.
Every
praise is to our God. Every word of worship with one accord. Every praise is to our God.
Sing hallelujah.
Sing hallelujah to our God. Glory hallelujah to our God. Every praise is to our God.
Sing it like you mean it, church. God our Savior.
And God my Savior. And God my healer. And God my deliverer. Yes, He is. Yes, He is. And God my praise is to our God. Every word of worship, one accord. Every praise is to our God.
Sing that again.
Every praise is to our God. Every word of worship, one accord. Every praise is to our God.
Let's give God praise tonight, church. Thank you, Heavenly Father. Lord God, we praise you. We glorify you, Lord God. Oh, boboro, shiora. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord God. We want to slow it down this evening, church. The Bible tells us to lift our hands in the sanctuary and bless the Lord. Let's do that tonight, church, as we sing this song, lifting our hands, giving God all the worship and the glory tonight, praising His name fervently. Let's sing this song out together. Holy forever.
Yes.
Thousand generations falling down in worship to sing the song of ages to the Lamb. And all who've gone before us, and all who will believe, will sing the song of ages to the Lamb.
Your name is the highest.
And your name is the highest. Your name is the greatest. Your name stands above them all. All thrones and dominions, all power. and positions. Your name stands above them all, and the angels cry, holy, all creations cry, holy, you are lifted.
If you walk in freedom,
and if you walk in freedom, and if you bear his name, sing the song forever to the Lamb. And we'll sing the song forever and amen, and the angels cry.
Service up in a word of prayer. We want to believe for God to move supernaturally this evening. We want to pray specifically for those we know are sick in their bodies. Let's be uplifting them, praying for healing. Let's be also uplifting this weekend as we approach Easter. Let's be praying that our friends, our family would come to church and get their hearts right with Jesus Christ, that we would see a great awakening. Let's be praying for the Easter March on Saturday there in Brisbane, believing that we would be able to take dominion in that place and establish the presence of God as we proclaim the name of Jesus Christ. Let's be praying that God would move this evening and bring a word in season for our lives. How many came you have a need in your heart? You'd raise your hands. I need Jesus to move. Let's pray. Let's bring every knee before the throne of grace this evening. Let's pray together, and then as we subside, I'm going to have Sanjay, if you could open us up in a word of prayer. Let's pray, church. Father God, we are so thankful that we could be gathered into your presence, Lord Jesus. I am God.
Oh, Heavenly Father God, Lord, we give you all honor and all glory tonight, Lord Father God. Lord, we lift your name in this place, Lord Father God, for there's no other name greater than your name. Lord, we command every demonic spirit, every wicked and evil twisted spirit, Lord Father God, we cast it into the pits of hell, Lord Jesus. Lord, we pray, Lord Father God, for this weekend, Lord Jesus, hallelujah, Lord, the Brisbane March, Lord Father God, that you will touch and transform lives, Lord Father God, that people will see that you're a holy God, Lord Father God, and you sacrifice for our sins, Lord Jesus. Lord, we lift up your name, Lord Father God. Lord, we pray for our Sunday Easter service, Lord Father God, Lord, that these flyers will reach into people's houses, Lord Father God, and Lord, that they would attend, Lord Father God, service for the communion and be a part of the congregation, Lord Father God, this Sunday. We pray, Lord Jesus, for visitors, Lord Father God, for new people to come and hear your word and have a transformed life, Lord Father God. Lord, we lift up, Lord Jesus, the churches in the harvest field. Lord, we pray, Lord Father God, for all the evangelists, Lord Father God, that you will continue using them and reaching and touching hearts throughout the world, Lord Father God. Lord, we lift up tonight's service, that your anointing hand be upon Pastor, Lord Father God, as he preaches a word to us tonight, that it will transform us, Lord Father God, that it will help us leave here as better Christians, Lord Father God. We ask for your blessing and your guidance in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Let's give God praise.
Amen. Let's make someone feel welcome tonight.
Praise God. I want to welcome you out tonight to our Wednesday evening service. I want to make you special feel welcome. So glad you could make it tonight to be here in the house of God on a Wednesday evening. Just want to bring a few things to your attention by the way of announcements. We do have tomorrow the playgroup, kids playgroup, ages 0 through to 4, 9:30 to 11:30. Then Good Friday is free for you to celebrate. Then our Easter March is at 10 a.m. in Brisbane. We're going to be going through the various different areas and street preaching. If you would like to street preach and you would you haven't already made it known to me, please make it known to me tonight so that I can send through the names and get you on the list to street preach as we stop in various different areas. And so that's going to be on Saturday, 10 a.m. at the Commonwealth Bank in the Brisbane Centre CBD area. Sunday morning, 9:30 for our Bible Hour, continuing our lessons from conflict resolution, looking at the life of David. And then 10:30 for our communion service. Evening service is a special service. We have our Easter service with a potluck dinner directly after, so we're going to have some fellowship. And so always a good opportunity to be in the house of God and be surrounded by our brethren and fellowshipping with one another. Next month we have a revival with evangelist Paul Boddy, and he's going to be coming all the way from the UK preaching the Thursday, Friday and Saturday.
We're doing a concert in the park on Saturday, and then Sunday morning, Sunday night as well. So all revival services, believing for a supernatural miracle there. We have an impact team to Springfield as well on the 20th of April, and plenty more things coming up in the future. Amen. Praise God. That's all we do have, by the way, of announcements. Why don't we change the order of the service? Let's give God praise. Our ushers come forward to take up an offering for us this evening. We have an incredible opportunity to give into the kingdom of God, and the Bible speaks about Matthew 6. It speaks about seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. All these things shall be added to you. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about its own things. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble. Jesus made it very clear God's going to take care of the flowers of the earth, the birds in the air. He will take care of us. And so let's be faithful to our tithes, our offerings. Don't forget your pledges, believing for God to move supernaturally through that. I'm going to ask if Jotham could pray, ask God's blessing upon the gift and the giver, please. Yes, Lord. Amen. You be blessed as you give tonight.
And give, and it will come back to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. And give, and it will come back to you. When you give, give to the Lord.
Thank you very much, musicians and those on the platform. If you brought your Bibles, let's turn to the book of Matthew chapter 7. Book of Matthew chapter 7, we'd be reading from verses 24 through to 27 out of the book of Matthew chapter 7, a sermon I've entitled, Crisis Reveals Character. Crisis Reveals Character. I've used this illustration multiple times many years ago. And it's around a retiring builder. This man had been building homes for a business owner for many years and finally was deciding to retire. But upon retiring, his this business owner employs this builder to build him one more house. In this final project, he approaches the builder and says, I want you to build me a house, and it is going to cost up to $500,000 you can spend on this house. $500,000, you choose what you want to put into it. And so this elderly builder, on the brink of retirement, began to think, well, you know what, I've worked my whole life as a builder and finally I'm coming to retirement. This business owner has so much money to spare that I'm going to build him the cheapest house I can and pocket all the profits, pocket all the rest of the remaining hundreds and thousands of dollars. And so he does. He goes to the Home Depot and he starts getting the budget wood, the budget cabinets, the budget cables and pipes, and he installs it in. And after 6 months of putting this house together at a very minimal budget price, he approaches the owner and says, here is your home, to which this business owner hands back the keys and says, this is your house for your retirement. Now, the moral of that story is simply that now this retired builder has to live with what he's built. Now, for anyone who's renovated, especially an older house, you know it costs more to renovate than actually to make from scratch. Think about the years of this man now having all the budget, everything that would have just lasted maybe 3 months, 6 months, a year, and now he's having to reinstall things for the rest of his life. He's going to be reminded of the time he cut corners, of the times that he did something that was not right. And the simple lesson from that is you get out what you put in. In the passage of scripture we're about to read, Jesus highlights that there are two types of people in the world. Those who listen and obey the word of God, and those who hear his word but do not obey it. And I pray this evening that God would help you to understand that he is a God that wants to bring revelation to your attention. He wants you to establish your life upon his firm foundation so that when crisis strikes, you would be able to survive it and it would develop in you a very strong character, a godly character. Crisis reveals character. Let's look firstly and let's read our text in the book of Matthew 7, 24 through to 27. The Bible says these words: "Therefore, whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I will liken him to a wise man who built his house on the rock, and the rain descended and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on the house, and it did not fall, for it was founded on the rock. But everyone who hears these sayings of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand, and the rain descended, the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, and it fell, and great was its fall." Crisis reveals character. Let's look firstly and let's focus at the base and build up. Because what Jesus is trying to highlight this evening is that every decision we make has an effect on us in the future. Whether you like to spend specific time on your appearance, on your knowledge and understanding, whatever you do to take time that develops your character today is going to help you in the future. The same works against you. Whatever you don't do, whatever you don't apply yourself to, whatever you neglect, will ultimately come and bite you in the butt. And so here is Jesus. He's saying, listen, there's no coincidences. It's not by luck. It's not let's hope our lucky stars all fall into place so that things work out good for me. What you put in, you get out. Life can be described or is a result of the teleology, and this is the study of end or purpose. In other words, this teleology stems from causality, which is the study of cause and effect. What did you do? That's why you got what you put in. It's not a mistake. It's not an accident. It's cause and effects. This can be studied, and this no doubt bleeds into your Christian walk. That if you decide to read your Bible once a year, that's the level of Christianity you'll have. If you decide to read your Bible maybe for a minute a day, 5 minutes a day, an hour a day, whatever it is, whatever you're putting in, you're going to get out. The same thing with serving God, ministry. If you want to develop your relationship with God, the more you put in, the more you get out. And so here is Jesus saying these are the two kinds of people that function in life. And these two types of worlds, no doubt, will never cross over into each other's worlds. In other words, someone that's lazy will never cross into someone who's just so disciplined. Right, just be like, hey, you know, here I am with you. It's like, no, it doesn't work like that. In Matthew 7, 24, verse 24 and then 26, I'll read these. "Therefore, whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I will liken him to a wise man who built his house on the rock. Verse 26, but whoever hears these sayings," again, they're both hearing, and does not do them will be like a foolish man who builds his house on the sand. And so what Jesus reveals is the wise person is one who listens to God's word, but not only listens to actually for the application of it. Why is Jesus speaking to me, and what is it that he is asking me to do right now? Now, growing up, I wasn't the best listener. In fact, this bled into my edumacation, right? In all honesty, there were times where I would sit in class and the teacher would say, this is what we're going to do today. But. And I would go, no probs. And I would walk away, go my own way, and come back and do something completely wrong. Simply because I didn't listen correctly. I didn't pay attention to the detail. For some of you, you may have done the same thing, right? How many of you have ever done an exam and you sat down and you read the question as you thought it was supposed to be read? You answered it to the best of your ability, and then you go back, or maybe you get the answers back and you go, oh, that's what they meant. Because sometimes it's lost in translation. And so we know that this must be developed in our character. Pay attention to the detail. If we don't, the tragedy is that we fall by the wayside of wisdom. We now inherit foolishness because we did not stop to ask or consider, why is Jesus saying this and how does he want me to apply this? The Bible says that there were two brothers, Cain and Abel. They were offering a sacrifice to God. They both took their produce from their work of their hands and both offered an offering to God. And in verse 3 and through to 5 in Genesis 4, in the process of time, it came to pass Cain brought an offering of the fruit of the ground to the Lord. Abel also brought of the firstborn of his flock and of their fat. And the Lord respected Abel and his offering, but he did not respect Cain and his offering, and Cain was angry and his countenance fell. What this scripture reveals is that there can be two people under the presence of God, given the same instructions, I want you to give me an offering, but one will be accepted and one will be rejected. And if you paid attention to that scripture, only one of the sacrifices came from the firstborn of his produce or of his flock and their fat. And so here is the difference. You could be in church, you could be doing everything that everybody else is doing, but if you are not specifically obeying what God is instructing you to do, you are now like the man that's building his house upon the sand. Notice both build a house. The wise and the foolish seem to have understood, I've got to build something. But how many know that God is concerned about the detail? God is concerned. Sometimes there are tests, right? It's like, I said this to see if you were listening. I've disclosed this to see if you're paying attention. And what separated both of these builders was their ability to hear, understand, and correctly obey the instructions from God. Now, it has to be more than just the physical structure, because how many know we could come to church, we could smile, have a big Bible in our hands, say amen at the right times, right? Amen. But is this really why Jesus has saved us? Is this really why Jesus has brought us into his purposes and plans, just so we can look like we know what we're doing? I want to look secondly this evening at the sand and storm. Because Jesus makes it very clear, stormy seasons will hit. How many are enjoying the rain? Just me. Okay, cool. Stormy seasons come. Can you say amen? Amen. And it seems as though we go from extreme heats and going, I am over this heat, to now I'm over the rain and I'd like some sunshine, right? Jesus doesn't hide the fact that the storms will hit. In fact, it's an oversight on our behalf if while building, we don't consider that there will be some stormy times. In fact, think about how Satan would look upon our lives. We leave now his kingdom. We now start building for God's kingdom. And it's almost as if we think, well, there's no test to be made. They've made their decision. They're going to build something for God, so let's leave them alone. But the distinction of the foolish and the wise is ultimately the location of their building. The rock, the Bible says, is that firm foundation, and the sand is this unpredictable, variable position. And it seems as though both houses stand for some time until crisis hits. Now, we cannot predict the future, and we cannot predict the extent by which we will suffer in a storm. Nevertheless, the Bible says the one who built on a firm foundation is the one who stands victorious. Both suffer from, verse 27, the rain, the floods, the winds. And the Bible says the one who built on the foolish, on the sand was foolish, and it fell, and great was its fall. And so naturally what we find is wisdom is attributed to the ability to live life in foresight rather than hindsight. It's your ability to actually think about what is the worst possible situation. If you ever need a lesson in that, call your insurance company, right? Because they will give you the worst possible situations. Are you protected for hail? I don't think so. Okay. And guess what? If it hails, they'll go, oh, you're not protected for that. And they'll remind you, you're not paying the excess. You have to pay us more if you want us to do that. Because they think of the worst possible. Okay, what if everything was to burn and all you were left with is structure? How much would that cost to rebuild? And if you're not careful with those numbers, this insurance will no doubt recant it. No, we're not giving you that money. We're not going to supply it for you. We're not going to take care of you because you didn't do your due diligence. It's living in foresight. It's your ability not necessarily to predict the future, but consider its effect on your life. Jesus spoke of the parable of the foolish and the wise virgins. The Bible says that the bridegroom was coming and there was a great wedding feast that was to be there. They were all invited, and the five foolish virgins brought their lanterns with no extra oil in their lamps. You know the story. The Bible says time passed, the bridegroom was delayed, and these foolish virgins went up to these others and said, listen, we need some oil, and sharing is caring, and they're trying their best. Please, we want to go into this wedding as well. We don't want to miss out. But as it would happen, the Bible says they would not share. So they go back to the city in verse 10, Matthew 25. And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went in with him to the wedding, and the door was shut. And that's where the foolish virgins end. Outside. Tragically, they missed out. And they're outside. Let me in. We were invited. And we hear those piercing words. I'm sorry, who are you? Pardon? What? That's foolishness. They did not prepare themselves for the possibility of the delay of the bridegroom. See, foresight becomes a lifesaver. Proverbs 2:11, the Bible says, discretion will preserve you. Understanding will keep you. The word discretion means a plan or a thought. It's simply saying, think before you speak. Isn't it? It's your ability to go, I know what I feel like saying, but if I say that to her, I'm going to get a slap on the face. Right? Do I look big in this dress? And you go, do I say, you know, it's right there, that moment to just plan and think about what you will say that will preserve you, give you understanding and keep you. And so here is Proverbs highlighting, listen, have you given some thought to what is to come? Have you considered the possibility of something maybe not working out? Now again, we're not talking about being pessimistic. If anything can go wrong, will go wrong. But you know, if you have an appointment at 6:30 and it takes you 30 minutes to get there, you would be foolish to leave at 6. Please say amen. Right? You'd be like, every green light, please, in the name of Jesus, right? And then you turn the corner and someone's crashed and you're like, really? You had to die today? Really? It's an inconvenience. You have to allow a buffer. You have to have some foresight and think, well, if I'm delayed, I don't want to be late, so why not allow 15 minutes just in case? These are the sorts of things that Jesus is challenging us. Now, having foresight includes three things. A foresight, number one, is a foresight in time. Is understand the power of time. Time depreciates things. If you get a car and you leave it, over time, it's going to get rusty and it's going to break down. Everything in life, unless it is weatherproof, life-proof, it will eventually break down and rot. And so if you don't have foresight, you will fail to understand the power of time. As you buy this brand new car and you put it all on credit and you drive it out of the lot and it is worth $60,000 and in 5 years you're still paying that off more than what it's worth and it is breaking down, you didn't plan for the tires, the servicing, the petrol, and all that incorporates in it, you have failed to understand the foresight of time. Looking at things in the future. The second foresight is the foresight in seasons. Is understand, I might be doing really well today, but I might not be doing well in times to come. I'm healthy today, right? It's like, yes, I feel great, you know? And so let's just do it. Let's just plan everything and cram it all in and just keep going. Let's don't stop. And then a season of being unhealthy comes. I spoke to a young man who got a home loan and his repayments didn't allow him to have a sick day. You know, he was 24. I'm like, yeah, you don't need sick days when you're 24. You live and let die, right? It's like, so you cannot go on holidays. You can't have a sick day. You have to work every morning, every night. I don't know about you, that's a house of cards. At one point, something's got to give. If you don't understand that, you're building your life on the sand. Is that there are seasons, and Mum used to always say, you need to save for a rainy day. Sometimes it pours because there are seasons. There are times where we increase. There are some times where we decrease, but ultimately we ought to prepare for those times so we don't feel the effects of it and we move into all that God has for us. The third area is the foresight of places. Is where I am today, where I want to be tomorrow. Because you have to understand that. Right? Some people get bogged down. I don't have a good job, or I don't have a great, you know, and it's like, that's it. And they see themselves in this isolated island, and you don't consider, well, do you think you'll always be there? Do you not think that, you know, even if you're out to sea, there's a current, you'll go somewhere. You're not going to stay the same place. If you don't incorporate this, you're building your life on the sand. So let's look thirdly and in closing. Because I want to leave us with the Lord and life. Because once you center your life around Jesus Christ, it never fails. And you need to say a louder amen to that. Because ultimately, Jesus is challenging us. Listen, I am speaking to you. And thank God, He's a God that speaks. He is trying to bring revelation to us. But God forbid, in between those two ears that we have, it just goes in and out and nothing stays and resonates. It has to do with obedience. Solid rock living is hearing Jesus and doing what He says. It is building for the future with eternal values in mind. In reality, Jesus isn't looking for a structure. He is looking for something that would stand the test of time. The tragedy today is that we don't notice the practical application of the Word of God, and we consider only the exterior, and then the seasons come, and how tragic it is. The Bible says, great was its fall. Nothing resonates with the unbeliever than seeing a Christian falling. It's like, oh, you go to church? Oh, yeah. So you're associated with all those priests and you're associated with that church. And yeah, it's like, you know, that's hard, right? It's tough for them to understand. It's even difficult to explain to them. No, they build their life on the sand. I'm building my life on the rock. So if you look at the context of this parable, if you have a Bible like mine, in this section here, it's build on the rock. But just prior, we have this time where Jesus is speaking to the religious leaders. He says, beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing. He's addressing a crowd that knows the truth, should be living by the truth, but is building their life on the sand. So this is not to the unbeliever. This is not to someone who is ignorant to who God is. It is actually a parable to try to attract the attention of those who profess to say, I am a child of God. In verse 22 through to 23, many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name, cast out demons in your name, and done many wonders in your name? And then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. We could say, those who build their lives on the sand. We have to be careful here that we do not get off track building something we think it's what Jesus wants, when in reality it's what we want. King Saul, the Bible says, was stripped from the kingdom because he simply disobeyed the words of the prophet Samuel. And it is in 1 Samuel 15:22. So Samuel said, has the Lord as a great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices, as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than to sacrifice. We quote that. We say, you know what? Just obey. Don't try to make up for what you haven't done. Just do what God is asking you to do. Listen and obey. But don't forget what it says in verse 23. Because Samuel follows that to obey is better than sacrifice with a statement that says rebellion is the sin of witchcraft and stubbornness is the sin of idolatry. Now try to grasp this. What are you trying to manipulate God to get him to do what you want him to do? That's witchcraft. What are you trying to twist? What are you trying to elevate into the position of God to say, yes, this is what God wants me to build, when in reality it's not? See, what we have to do is tune into what Jesus is saying. Tune into what he is trying to get you to understand. That his ways are not your ways. But ultimately, you would build something that would stand the test of time. My prayer is that every single one of us, if Jesus was to delay the rapture, we'd still be serving Jesus Christ. There'd be storms, there'd be winds, there'd be all kinds of craziness, and we'd be absolutely safe in the house. Why? Because we've built it on the rock. In the end, the means should justify the ends. God is looking for people that would be willing to build for the long haul. Don't just build for the sake of building. Build something that would last. Build something that would protect you in years to come. I close with this. Think about Noah's ark. God spoke to him and said, I want you to build an ark and your family is going to be in it. Imagine if he just cut a few corners. Imagine if all of a sudden the rain started to descend and the ark starts to like creep up and then it started to sink. Don't allow that. Our challenge is, God, what is it that you're trying to tell me? What is it that you need me to hear so that I can apply and so that I could develop a character that would preserve me through every storm? That's all I have. Why don't we bow our heads? Let's close our eyes this evening. No one's moving around just for a few moments. The presence of God is in this place. Crisis reveals character. Every head's bowed and every eye's closed. We're going to open these altars up for a time of prayer. If you're here this evening and you don't know Jesus Christ, I want to give you this opportunity right now to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, to have him come into your heart, to transform you from the inside out. The Bible says, appointed unto man to die and then face judgment. Every single one of us will have to stand before God and give an account for our lives. If you're here this evening and you don't know Jesus Christ, I want to declare to you, here's the answer. He can transform you. He can set you free. He can give you a brand new life, a brand new start. And if you're here this evening and you don't know Jesus Christ, by confessing with your mouth and believing with your heart, you can be born again. If that's you, God's dealing with you tonight, you'd raise your hand and say, yes, pray for me. Just so I know who to pray for this evening, you'd raise your hand, we'd have someone lead you through a sinner's prayer and invite Jesus Christ to be your Lord and Savior. Every head's bowed and every eye's closed. You say, yes, that's me. I'm lifting up my hand. I want to pray. I want to get my heart right. Amen. And changing the order of the service this evening, I want to open these altars up for a time of prayer. I want to stir you and challenge you this evening to tune in to what Jesus Christ is asking you to do. These altars are open. Why don't we come? Let's pray. Let's ask God to help us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
You give life. You are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore. That is broken.
Yes, Lord Jesus. Yes, Lord Jesus, we pour out our praise to you, Lord Father God, for you are worthy to be praised.
In our lives, so we pour out our praise to you.
Yes, yatere bebe bebe me 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 sri anda ram ram ma 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 sri oto ro ro mo. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Give glory to you,
you
Father
give
God. Restore that hope in you once again, Lord Father. Yes, Lord Jesus.
Every heart that is broken.
Great are you. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to Jesus Christ. Yes, and all the earth will shout your praise. And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. Yes, all the earth. And all the our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. Yes, it's your breath. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath. In our lungs, so we pour out, yes, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you, Jesus. Let's give God praise in this place. Let's worship. Hallelujah, hallelujah. The devil would love you to not know the word of God. Because the less you know when God speaks to you, it just won't marry up. You'll be going, is that from God? Or is that me? Or is that TikTok? What, you know, where's that from? It's the more you know the word of God, it's easier to obey. You go, yeah, that's God. That's what I've got to do. Why don't we seal off in a word of prayer? Thank you so much for coming out tonight. We're going to believe for God to help us. Have an incredible weekend coming up. Pastor Dylan Stokes, if you could seal us off, please.
Heavenly Father, we thank you, God, for this time and message. God, I pray, Father, you'll help us, God, build our lives on the rock and on your word, God. Help us to seek wisdom, God, when we don't know. My God, I pray, Father, you'll bless us this week. Bless this weekend in Jesus' name.
Amen and amen. If you are wanting to street preach, let me know tonight, please.